Chapter 31, B. I was then witness to a morbid parade of faces, which changed one to another without evidence of the seams between them. The first that shimmered in the depth was the face of the old woman, who had been buried beside me in the clearing. She was the same from whom I had inherited the St. Christopher medallion. As she smiled up to me so warmly, she appeared so much alive there under the water. A wonderful coal was lit in the center of my chest, which is that incomparable symptom of love which flickers when we remember those we've lost. She was my grandmother, Mazie, who was that immovable affection in my impossible childhood. She raised the St. Christopher medallion from about her neck, kissed it once, and smiled to me through the aqua face. I was lost in the magic of seeing her there, so real, which left me unprepared for the change which overtook her suddenly. Without warning, her face was replaced by the head of that great black jaguar who had drowned beneath those falls. I reached into the water to rescue my grandmother, screaming, "No!" My hands returned empty, finding no substance in the shoal. The water settled again. Another face began emerging there. As it became clear, it was the face of that pilot, my father, looking up to me. It was that granite countenance as he raised his index finger to his lips in the manner of hushing me. And in his gentle voice, which came rising through the surface there, he said, "Time and forgetting, Christopher. Time and forgetting. Time and forgetting." I blinked away the fierce tears from my eyes, my heart in a tangle in my chest. As I was responding to him, before even the slightest utterance, his head too replaced by that menacing skull of the great black cat. Again, I plunged my fist into those waters, but there was nothing beneath the surface but more of that water itself. I was mad. Mad from the mix of that swirl and the death vapor which had consumed all but me in that landscape. And with that resignation from sanity, a final face did appear in the shallows. It was the most wrenching of all, for it was the face of Jakob as he slept. As I had seen him in that veil of such innocence, I was reminded of the sweetness and goodness and faithfulness of him, but was then rushed with the panic for fear of that cat's return to claim him. "Run, Jacob, go, run, that cat comes for you." I screamed into the surface, and again that blasphemous cat's head appeared upon the body of that little boy. My hands again plumbed the waters, wrestling for the head of that beast who was claiming those who deserved it least. I cried to the heavens, "What is this? Why do you torture me thus? How I suffer and suffer. Again you show me those whom I have lost. I say to you darkly, you are a motherless whore. And I am the savage who fears you not.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, girl, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine. Well, they said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, they said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, you ain't ever caught a rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound dog.